Neighbor, say, you are welcome to the house of God. It's a great thing to be here this morning. Amen.
Amen.
I want to thank our Father, Father Francis Otuo Sribo, for giving me the opportunity to stand before you and share the word of God. I pray that God will continue to bless him and be with him wherever he is, even in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that you speak through my vocal cords and speak through me. Use me, O God, to dish out divine revelation unto your people, even in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Please open your Bibles. Let's go to Psalms chapter 16, the first reading. Psalms chapter 16, verse 8 to 10. Psalms 16, verse 8 to 10.
I am always aware of the Lord's presence. He is near, and nothing can shake me. And so I'm thankful and glad, and I feel completely secure, because you protect me from the power of death. I have served you faithfully, and you will not abandon me to the world of death. Amen.
Amen. My version says, New Living Translation says, I know the Lord is always with me. I will not be shaken, for he is right beside me. No wonder my heart is filled with joy and my mouth shouts his praise. My body rests in safety, for you will not leave my soul among the dead or allow your godly one to rot in the grave. Turn to your neighbor and say, God will not leave your soul to rot.
God won't leave your soul to rot.
Turn to somebody and say, God will not allow you to rot.
God will not allow you to rot.
Now, the reason why we have to have confidence that we will not get rotten is not because we know how to preserve ourselves, but because we know, as this version that you read, the Good News Translation says, I am aware that the Lord is with me. The confidence of the believer that he is totally preserved, he is totally saved, he is totally sound at all times, rests in God alone. And that is why when you read it from the beginning, he says, I know the Lord is always with me. I know the Lord is always with me. Those that know how much God is with them are not afraid of getting rotten. Onipa onimse onyankopon kaneho all the time. Sanipa no owo confidence at all times. Said there is nothing that the enemy can do which can bring me down. Now when he's talking about you will not allow your Holy One to rot, you will not allow me to rot in the grave. We are not just referring to your physical body dying and getting rotten, but we're also talking about every aspect of your life. That comes in different forms. You know, your finances can die. Your relationship can die. Your marriage can die. Your business can die. But if the Lord is with you, you have confidence that I may look dead, but I cannot be buried. I may even be buried, but I cannot be rotten. Listen, the story of Lazarus must make us understand that irrespective of how much we think it is too late, it can never be too late in the eyes of God. We have to understand that irrespective of how you think you are knocked out of life, irrespective of how you think you cannot move ahead in life, and irrespective of how you think you cannot make it anymore, you have to know that as long as I have the presence of God with me, I cannot be rotten. In other words, as long as I have the presence of God with me, failure is not an option. Disgrace is not an option. Humiliation is not an option. I cannot be cast out. I cannot be out of the game. I always have hope in the Lord. Please start again for us.
I am always aware of the Lord's presence.
I am always aware of the Lord's presence. I want to ask you a question. What are you always aware of? What are you always aware of? Somebody is saying, David said, as for me, I'm always aware of the presence of God. A And many of us are also always aware of our social standing. We are always aware of the kind of friends we have. We are always aware of our family background. We are always aware of the connections that we have. We are always aware of the financial position that we have. And that is why when a challenge comes, you run quickly to what you are aware of. I am always aware that the Lord is with me. Listen, awareness moves beyond a certain level of knowledge. Awareness brings an automatic trust. Now, many of us, when we come to church, we don't check whether the chair is safe for us to sit on because we are aware that it is safe. So automatically the chair is offered, we sit down because we are aware that it is safe for me to sit on. If you are aware that the Lord is with you, you will trust him. If you are aware, there is no way anything will come at you and you will give up. Because irrespective of the challenge,
Amen.
I am always aware. I'm always aware. If there is anything we must be aware of, it is the presence of God. If you are always aware of the presence of God, you acknowledge him in all your ways. Trust in the Lord in all your ways. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him. Be aware of him in all your ways. Be aware of him all the time. Please start again.
I am always aware.
I am always aware
of the Lord's presence.
Of the Lord's presence.
He is near.
He is near. Listen.
And nothing can shake me.
He is near and nothing. Listen, God is closer to you than you think. God is nearer to you than you think. He said he is near. Because he is near, nothing can shake me. Turn to your neighbor and say, no shaking.
No shaking.
Turn to somebody and say, no shaking.
No shaking.
Turn to yourself and say, no shaking in my life.
No shaking in my life.
Shake your pocket and say, no shaking in my pocket.
No shaking.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I know that he is near and therefore I will not shake. Nothing can shake me. Be beyond to me, wusu, miss her. I cannot hear the name of a disease and be scared because I know he is near me. Because he is near me, 1,000 shall fall at my side, 10,000 at my right hand, because he is near me. Because he is near me, the enemy shall rise against me, but the Lord will make a way for me. Because he is near me, I may be sick. Everybody may think I will die, but I will not die, but live and declare the good works of God. Because he is near me. May the Lord be near you.
Amen.
If somebody is near you, you feel his presence. If somebody is near you, you feel his influence. If somebody is near you, he does stuff for you. If somebody is near you, he counsels you. If somebody is near you, he helps you. Se onyanko pon kawo na se onyanko pon benwa obuao. Se onyanko pon kawo na se onyanko pon benwa or advice. Se onyanko pon kawo na se onyanko pon benwa or shewun cry. And that is why some people may not understand the source of your encouragement. I don't have anybody encouraging me, but I have God by my side. And so David said, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil because you are with me. Not because I'm connected, because you are with me. If there is anything that we need, it is the presence of God. It is the presence of God. Moses understood the presence of God so well. He said, God, if you are not going with us, then you better forget it. We are going to abandon the whole mission, because without you in the equation, we are doomed to fail. Without you in the equation, we are doomed to perish. Without you in the equation, we can't achieve the mission. Without you in the equation, the vision will be aborted. Without you in the equation, the business will collapse before it begins. Without you in the equation, the church collapses before it starts. Without you in the equation, the pregnancy is terminated even before the seed is conceived. But with you in the equation, with God, all things are possible. All things are possible to those who rest in the awareness of the presence of God. All things are possible to those who are conscious of God's presence. Somebody cannot be near you and you will not be conscious of his presence. Listen, we have to learn how to practice the consciousness of his presence. We have to constantly remind ourselves of God's presence. There are many people, when they are in relationships and marriages and stuff like that, they always want to be reassured. They ask, do you love me? All the time. Do you love me? The person says yes. Do you love me? The person says yes. Sometime ago, I asked a husband, do you love your wife? They were there together. I asked, do you love your wife? Look at me and give me the response. Asked the wife, do you love your husband? He said, I like him. So I said, so you guys are tolerating one another. May the Lord give us grace.
Amen.
You see, they are with one another, but you see, the consciousness of one another's love is absence. Listen, many of us are aware of God's presence. Listen, I say again, many of us are aware of God's presence, but we are not aware of his presence with us. Am I making sense? We know God is present. When we come to church, we believe he is present. In the universe, we believe he is present. So when we ask you, do you believe God exists? We say yes. But you have forgotten that God's presence is for you. And the way you carry the consciousness of the presence of God is to acknowledge him in everything you do, and to know that my confidence, my hope, my faith, my trust is in nothing but in Jesus. And that is why, if somebody asks you why you will make it in life, you tell the person, because God is with me. Why do you think you have a future? Because God is with me. Can you also give birth? Yes. What's yours? God is with me. Can you also get married? Yes. Why? God is with me. Can anything good come out of your life? Yes. God is with me. May the Lord be with you.
Amen.
Please continue.
And so I'm thankful and glad, and so I feel completely secure.
I'm thankful and glad, and I feel completely
secure.
I love that. I feel completely secure. When God comes into your life, he gives you a sense of security that no one else can. That is why you can smile at the storm, because your sense of security existed even before the storms came. God does not show up in our lives when trouble comes. He is with us already before the trouble comes. And so if he allows the trouble to come, then know that he is well able to deal with it. If you have this mindset, you will have a sense of security. If you have this mindset, nothing that the enemy does will shake you. If you have this mindset, you will face that devil and win. If you have this mindset, you will never be a quitter. If you have this mindset, you will never give in. If you have this mindset, you will never be defeated. You will always be an overcomer. Because listen, I am safe and I am secure. The reason why many people run away from stuff even before they enter into it is fear, insecurity. Some people abandoned marriages because they were insecure in the relationship. So the person says, even if I'm insecure in this, then I can take it a step further. And we want to adopt the same mindset when it comes with our work with the Lord. Hallelujah. Yeah. Thank you. Why will you get married? Oh, Father, you come to Father. Oh, Father, then I'm going to get married next year. Why? He gave me a promise ring. You are a joker. Your confidence of the marriage should not be in the ring. It should be in the God who is with you. If it is in the ring, you will be disappointed. If it is in God, you will never be disappointed. Even if that person steps out of your life, you see it as God ordering your steps into something better. Therefore, I'm secure. When this disease came, many people, when they are walking, they are just scared. We have been sneezing before COVID-19 came. We've been coughing before it came. But once somebody sits or stands by you and sneezes 3 times, you begin to run away. And many of us are now feeling very safe because we wear nose mask. Fantastic. One day when the president was giving an address, he said they conducted a survey and they realized that many people are wearing the nose mask. He said, however, 80% of those who wear the nose mask don't wear it properly. 80%. So it means the whole Ghana, only 20% are quote-unquote protected by the nose mask. It means your protection is not in the nose mask. It is in God. Many people attend seminars and conferences. They come out of the conference worse than they ever entered. Because they went there hoping that a man would give them a key to unlock certain mysteries. A man will give them a key that will help them. A man will give them an information that will turn their lives around. A man will tell them something that will turn their situation around. If only we can call on the Lord. No wonder many people come to Father after they have gone to hospital and they've wasted all their money. Because God is not the first point of call. If God had been your first point of call, probably you wouldn't have gone to that hospital. So you waste all that, and then you come to the man of God, and he prays a prayer for you, and you realize that you'll be very stupid. By trying to rely on men instead of on God. I am aware that the Lord is with me. Therefore, there is no shaking in my life, and therefore, I'm totally secure. Continue, sir.
I feel completely secure because you protect me from the power of death.
Because you protect me from the power of death. Let's take the words. I thank God he didn't just say, you protect me from death. He didn't say, you protect me from death. He said, you protect me from the power of death. It means death operates by a mechanism. So if he's saying that you operate me, you protect me from the power of death, he was saying that you protect me from the mechanism by which death comes. You protect me by the means by which death, or from the means by which death operates. You protect me from the ways that the enemy deals with people, from the ways that the enemy kills destinies and visions and children and marriages and finances and businesses. You protect me from that means. And that is why our Father always says that behind every word, there is a word. In other words, there is always a mechanism by which something happens. And so when he was saying you protect me from the power of death, he was saying that because relationship, you are still protected. You protect me from the power of death. So if something is dead in my life, the only person I can run to for safety and the only person that can deliver me is God. And he said, call unto me in the day of trouble and I will answer you and I will show you great and mighty things. Why does he tell us to call upon him? Because he has the solution to the problem. Why does he say we should call upon him? Because he knows that anytime the devil strikes, he alone has the antidote to what the enemy will do. In fact, he foreknew the plans of the enemy against your life even before you were born. So whilst the devil thought he was devising a new plan, to God it was an old strategy that was already dealt with. And that is why with God by your side, you can move from victory to victory to victory, because nothing is new to God. He knew everything even before it began. Before the beginning began, God already existed. You protect me from the power of death. Somebody may use his word to kill your business. Just a word from somebody. I wanted to help him, but I listened to so-and-so talking about him. I've changed my mind. I know many of you can relate. I wanted to do business with him. But yesterday, a friend of his told me something about him, and I have changed my mind. He has killed some aspect of you. A word. A death can also come as a result of an action. From you, it can be from somebody else. Sometimes the devil will use you against you in order to get you. That's the most potent weapon of the enemy, to use you against yourself. Somebody wanted to be helped with a job. When they called the person to come for the job, the way he packaged himself, he just came out of the ghettos with his wee attire, or let me say wee uniform, carrying the aroma and influence of the place he came out of, and stepped into the office of the one who would help him. The person just looked at him and said, I will call you. Till the call never came. The devil used him against himself to kill his job, and till today, he's jobless. The devil can even kill your helper in order to get you. I want to help you. When I was in school, I was hosting somebody on radio station, and the man had a telecom company. And he told me that I like you a lot. When you finish your national service, or when you finish school, I will give you a job in my company. I became swollen-headed. I was doing my national service when he died. Something that could have come out of that man was dead along with his death. May your destiny help us live long.
Amen.
May those assigned to help you live long.
Amen.
May your husband not die before you meet him.
Amen.
May your wife not die before you meet him.
Amen.
May your business partners not die before you meet them.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Why do you think that Herod killed many young children? Male children. Why? Because he was after one. He was after one. And because he was trying every means to stop that one from stepping into his destiny, he decided to wage war on everybody else. Sometimes a crisis that people around you are going through is because God knows that if they are set free, you will be liberated. And sometimes you are also going through stuff. You are going through some death in your life because the enemy knows that when you are set free from that particular area, you will be able to step into your destiny. But listen, it comes to an end today. You protect me from the power of death.
Amen.
On you free owo to means him.
Amen.
I say wo bom me hum pine free owo nsem. Wo yi me free owo to means him. Natural says owo be to me a tuma wo abra bom a. It relies on to me a ekitano. It is a me to me tin to me free nsem a owo nya shebim. And that is why at the point he said, oh death, where is your sting? Where is it? Where is your power? Death, where is it? Because your power has been snatched from you. What makes the person who he is the power that he has. If we go to the polls and vote him out, he does not have that power anymore. He can give all the updates in the world. They tell us all the guidelines in the world. It will never work because that power is taken from him. The best way to deal with death is to deal with the power of death. And that is exactly what Jesus did. And that is exactly what God does when he is with you. Before the enemy strikes, he goes ahead of you to deliver you. And that is why he said, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. He said, I will help you. I will protect you. He said, I will uphold you with my right hand. That is the promise of the Lord. May that promise be realized in your life.
Amen.
Please continue.
I have served you faithfully.
I have served you faithfully.
And you will not abandon me to the world of the dead.
Please take it again.
I have served you faithfully.
I have served you faithfully.
And you will not abandon me.
And you will not abandon me.
To the world of the dead.
To the world. Thank you, Jesus. To the world of the dead. So if we have the world of the dead, then we have the world of the living. And the world of the dead belongs to those who have been abandoned by God. Because he said, you will not abandon me to the world of the dead. To abandon is to take of life. These are things that can be found in the world of the dead. So if God is with you, then he will take you out of the world of the dead. And what I'm telling you is that if the Lord is with you, then he will take you out of the world of the dead finances in which you find yourself. The Lord will take you out of the world of the dead situation in which you are. The Lord will take you out of the situation of the sickness in which you are. Because you will not abandon me. Listen to me. He did not say you will not go through it with me. There are times that you may experience stuff and you think you are part of the world of the dead. The times that God allows you to have certain experiences, but even in the midst of those experiences, you must be rest assured that he will never abandon you. There are times that God by himself exposes you to certain stuff. But even as he has exposed you to those stuff, you still have a reason to say that He will never abandon me. As Job said, irrespective of what I'm going through, I know my Redeemer lives. And he is with me. I know my Redeemer lives. And since I know my Redeemer lives, my friends can criticize me. I don't care. Since I know my Redeemer lives, my wife can be my chiefest critic. I still don't care. Since I know my Redeemer lives, my wife can still leave me. I don't care. My Redeemer lives. My body is full of sores. I still don't care. I know that since that man who created me is still there, the man who once blessed me with children, the man who once blessed me with a wife, the man who once blessed me with businesses, the one who once blessed me with wealth, as long as he is alive, at the end of it all, his glory will be seen.
Amen.
You will not abandon me. Anyone who is abandoned is alone. There is a team who says, you never walk alone. But sometimes you see them walking alone in their jerseys. You don't walk alone. I have somebody with me at all times. I don't walk alone. You will never abandon me. Abandoning somebody, for you to be abandoned, if you have really experienced it before, it can just crush your spirit. A sense of rejection can just crush you. People emotionally halt every move of yours. A sense of being, of feeling abandoned can cause you a lot. In the same way, a sense of acceptance gives you morale and confidence. That is why teams, a lot of the times, they do well when they are playing at home. Because at home, they are more accepted. They have a lot of people who are cheering them on at home. But when they go outside, the boos, a lot of the times, are more than the cheers. And that alone works on their subconsciousness and affects their play most of the time. And so if the Lord says, I will never abandon you, or if David had realized that the Lord will never abandon him, then he knows that he has a source of motivation and encouragement, and that is God himself. It means that God always cheered him on. It means that God always encouraged him. It means that God always gave him a reason to keep on keeping on. You may be down, but if God is with you, you have a reason to keep hoping. And that is why the Bible says there is hope for a tree. That even when you cut it down, the stem is dried and the roots are dead in the soil. At the scent of water, it will sprout again. There is always hope under an open heaven. Rains are made possible under an open heaven. Anytime the presence of God comes, the windows of heaven are open. And anytime the windows of heaven are open, the dews of heaven begin to fall. And anytime the dews of heaven fall, there is a revival. There is a refreshing. There is a new beginning. There is a new hope. Thank God you are in new hope. You will never abandon me in the world of the dead. The world of the dead. In the world of the dead, they have their own language. In the world of the dead, they have the way they do their stuff. In the world of the dead, they have stuff that influence them. In the world of the dead, they have a different rule. In the same way, in the world of the living, or if somebody steps out of the world of the dead and enters the world of the living, he begins to notice a change by himself. He begins to feel uncomfortable by himself. If anybody resurrects and realizes that he's in a casket, the first thing he will do is to crash that casket and come out. May the Lord bring somebody out.
Amen.
You will not abandon me in the world of the dead. Wonderful. You will never be abandoned.
Amen.
Your dead marriage is coming back to life.
Amen.
I prophesy in the oil of our Father. Your dead business is coming back to life.
Amen.
The dead you is coming back to life.
Amen.
The dead vision is coming back to life.
Amen.
I prophesy under this grace in the name of Jesus Christ that as many as under the sound of my voice, whether you are watching or you are here in this auditorium, whatever is dead in your life is coming back to life.
Amen.
Whatever is dead is coming back to life.
Amen.
Businesses are 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 coming back to life.
Amen.
In the mighty name of the Lord Jesus.
Amen.
I speak to somebody who has abandoned a good idea because you think you don't have what it takes. Listen to me. The Lord is with you and he will bring it back up.
Amen.
I came to speak to somebody who has given up over a particular cause, that in the name of the Lord Jesus, press it again, do it again, try it again.
Amen.
Do it again. This time around, life will come out of that.
Amen.
This time around, something will come out.
Amen.
This time around, some hope will come out.
Amen.
This time around, there will be a revival.
Amen.
Try it again, do it again. Try it again. Do it again. The Lord is on your side.
Amen.
Do it again. The Lord is on your side. He will revive that. The Lord is on your side. He will bring the marriage to life. The Lord is on your side. He will bring the children back to life. The Lord is on your side. The finances will resurrect. If the spirit of him that raised Christ from the dead dwells in you, that same spirit that raised Christ from the dead will quicken your mortal body. I prophesy in the name of Jesus, a quickening by the spirit of the living God, a revival by the power of the Holy Ghost. I prophesy under the influence of this grace, in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus, a move of the Holy Ghost in the life of the people of God, a move of the anointing in the life of the people of God, a move of the unction of God in every area of your life. Yesterday you were dead, today you are alive.
Amen.
Yesterday you could not make it, today you can make it.
Amen.
Yesterday you were a failure, today you are successful.
Amen.
Yesterday you were sick, today you are healed.
Amen.
Yesterday you were broke, today you are prosperous.
Amen.
Yesterday you stagnated, today you are moving forward.
Amen.
Yesterday you fell down, well today you are rising up.
Amen.
For the righteous shall fall seven times, but each time he falls, the spirit of the Lord will pick him back up. May the Lord pick you back up. May the Lord pick you back up. May the Lord pick you back up. May the Lord revive you in your spirit. Revival in your soul. Revival in your body. May you receive grace. Receive grace. Receive grace. Receive life. Receive life. Receive life. You are coming out of the world of the dead and you are entering the world of the living. You are coming out of the world of the poor and wretched and timid and disgraced and ashamed and humiliated, and you are entering the world of the influential, the world of the alive, the world of the quickened, the world of the known, the world of the famous, the world of the prosperous, the world of the successful. In the mighty name of the Lord Jesus, yesterday the devil overcame you because you were too weak to respond. You were too dead to respond. Well, today the devil is a liar, because when he tries it, he comes ahead of something he cannot handle. When the enemy tries it, yesterday you were just a cold something, but today you are a flaming fire to the glory of the Lord. May the heavens be open and let the life of God be released. May the heavens be open, let the glory of God pour forth. May the heavens be open, let divine protection be released. May the heavens be open, let God utter a word of deliverance. May the where heavens be open, let God touch the life of somebody. May the heavens be open, let life be released into your spirit. May the heavens be open, let there be a move of God and the power of the Spirit of God. May the heavens be open and let there be newness of life.
Amen.
May the Lord bless you.
Amen.
May the Lord be with you.
Amen.
Even in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Give the Lord a clap offering, somebody. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Let's take our tithe and offerings, please.